Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Church of Evanston. I'm Andy Fisher, your bellboy, and I'll be your worship associate this morning. Whether this is your spiritual home or you are newly discovering this community, we're grateful to share this time with you this morning. We share to be an inclusive and welcoming community, seeking the truth in love and nurturing the human spirit for a world made whole. We are guided by our principles and values, which remind us in every moment and through every challenge that each of us is worthy of love and that we are all connected through the vast and beautiful web of existence. We come together to remember our kinship with one another and to hold one another in heart and mind with tenderness and careful attention, and to dedicate ourselves more fully to living our shared values. People of all ages are welcome and an important part of our faith community. We are blessed to have the children in the sanctuary for the first part of every service, and the entire service is welcome for all about once a month. The nest in the front is our designated area for families with one children, where we have a quiet fidget toys and activities and kid-friendly order of service. Nursery care is available in room 11 every Sunday. As part of being a welcoming community, we have some information posted on the screen that will help orient you to UCE and our services. We have a few announcements. An informal UCE task force is asking the Board of Trustees to include a ceasefire resolution on the agenda for vote at the May 19th annual meeting. Please join us today at 11:45 in room 6 after the service for the first town hall meeting on the resolution. UCE will host the Chicago Area UU Council Spring Conference on Saturday, April 13th. The conference theme is Welcoming Congregational Renewal. The work of welcome is never done. Come join us to learn, support, and gather momentum in our collective welcoming work. You can go to uuchicago.org for more details and registration. On April 27th, UCE will have a team in the walk roll in the Red Line event planned by Open Communities. This event is an opportunity to walk the historical redlined route through Evanston's 5th Ward. The route will celebrate Black Evanstonian contributions, provide opportunities to welcome Black-owned businesses, and demonstrate the ways to take action for housing justice today. To join the UCE team, please see Mary Beth Roth or Dana Deanne at one of the program tables after the service today. For the worship service next Sunday, you are invited to bring a little soil from your garden, yard, or flower pot in a baggie so we can participate in our first Earth Communion. And now, let us settle into our shared time of reflection, celebrate, and inspiration. As we begin our worship service, those joining us online are invited to gather your chalice as we join in beloved community.
Our opening reading is We Are One by Reverend Carol Thomas Sissel. We are one. We are family. We are connected by blood and bone, mind and heart, and sometimes bricks and mortar, like the finest woven tapestries of old and the spices blended and stirred into our family's secret recipes. Our lives are intentionally intertwined. And we are made, no, we are fashioned into a stronger community by those connections. This interlacing, intertwining, and intermingling of our existence makes each of us whole. This interlacing of our lives makes us whole, happiness and sorrow. This intertwining of our lives makes us whole, blessings and burdens. This intermingling of our lives makes us whole, lament and laughter. May we allow the magic and mystery, often named spirit, to keep us connected long after today's service has ended. Come, let us worship together this morning.
The Unitarian Church of Evanston resides on land that was recorded as being transferred from the local Potawatomi community to the U.S. government in 1829 Shortly before the Potawatomi in this area were forcefully removed west of the Mississippi River. This land was then sold to white settlers. We remember the ancestors of contemporary African Americans, the individuals, families, and networks of black people who built up our country's culture and economy, a role forced on them originally by enslavement. We acknowledge the intentional violence that was landed on North America shores in 1619, had continued through the generations, and remains a reality today. These acknowledgments are one small effort toward building long-term solidarity with contemporary communities. We commit ourselves to take what we learn here today and incorporate it into our lives and turn our thoughts into actions. Please join in our words of shared commitment. We name these realities with honor for all our ancestors, respect for our descendants, and gratitude for the land we use as sacred space. Carolyn Lachlan brought the flowers in honor of all the UCE members and friends who are working hard to protect our democracy. As we share our chalice symbol of our living tradition, please join in saying the words on the screen by Reverend Carol S. Sissel. We are one. We are family. We are connected. This interlace of our lives makes us whole, happiness and sorrow. This intertwining of our lives makes us whole, blessings and burdens. This intermingling of our lives makes us whole, lament and laughter. Please rise in body and spirit and join in saying the words of our covenant. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Before we sing our opening hymn, I invite those joining us online to greet each other in the chat, and those gathered in the sanctuary to turn to one another briefly to say good morning, trying to greet someone you is new to you.
Service and continue your conversations. If you're new to UCE, please stop by the welcome table with the red tablecloth at the back, just in front of the large mural. That's where you can get some answers to your questions and learn more about us. Let's keep creating new relationships and building kinship among us. Our hymn is number 134, Our World is One World.
Oh,
Adam, is this on yet? Okay, good. Does anyone know what's happening tomorrow? Okay. I thought maybe I'd... What's happening tomorrow? Yes! Oh my gosh, you got ahead of me. Beautiful. Yes, we're close. So tomorrow's the... Sorry. Yeah. This is a picture that Kathy Underwood's husband Todd took at the last time we had the solar eclipse, which I think is pretty cool. The total solar eclipse. So the total solar eclipse, which we, I think most of us know, is when the Earth is, and the Earth and the Moon and the Sun are all in a path, right? So the Moon is casting a shadow on the Earth. We all know what a shadow is, right? You've seen your shadow. It's just when the sun is facing you, the shadow's behind you, right? That's what's happening with the solar eclipse. Here's something I didn't know or I didn't think about before. The moon is 400 times smaller than the sun and also 400 times nearer to us, which makes it that those two disks in the sky look the same size. So if... The solar eclipse wouldn't happen if either were larger or smaller or nearer or farther away, which I think is pretty cool and remarkable. This visual phenomenon of the moon's shadow completely blocking or eclipsing the sun depends on where we are on the Earth. This is called the path of totality, like you said, meaning the path that the moon's shadow will travel across the Earth tomorrow. Here's an image... Sorry, that's not right. It's supposed to be. Here's an image of the path of totality, and you can see the red arrow is where the Chicagoland area is, where we are right now. And we won't be in the path of totality, but we'll be in about 80%. We'll get about 80% of the sun's blocked before about starting at about 1 p.m. and then peaking just after 2 p.m. What do you got for me, Lucas? It's 93.9 is where we are here. Seriously? Thank you for correcting me. I was like trying to figure out on that map, like, is it 80? You're awesome. I love it. So that's not bad, right? Like, we can see it pretty well from here. Most of us in the staff and the ministers are traveling places to get in that path of totality. I'm heading tomorrow, just driving as south and east as I can to try to get as close to that path of totality. But if you're here tomorrow in Evanston and you're looking for a place to observe the solar eclipse, you are so welcome to sit on our south lawn, bring a lawn chair or a blanket, and make sure you have your special solar glasses, or you can make your very own cereal box solar viewer. It really works. I made this by watching a YouTube video. Anybody want to check this out? You can make one. You can just look at it. You can try. You like put your eye in and you try to get the light underneath it. Well, it might not work great, but it works in the sun. It does. I promise. Yeah, it works. You just don't want to stare directly at the sun, right? So the next solar eclipse is going to be August 12th, 2045. 21 years from now. So think about how old you'll be 21 years from now. Pretty old. Long ago, before people understood the way that the moon orbits the Earth and the Earth orbits the sun, they were frightened when they saw the solar eclipse. Can you imagine what that would have been like? Like, here's the sun that's always in the sky, and then all of a sudden it's being devoured. They thought that a great dragon or a great beast was devouring the sun, and some of them even like shot arrows at the beast that was eating the sun. Of course, now we understand that we are part of a vast solar system with lots of stars and planets and satellites moving around each other in various orbits. And what we see in the sky depends on where we are on the Earth and in relation to all the other celestial bodies in the universe. It's a great example of how all life on our planet is connected. All energy comes from the sun, and we are all connected and dependent upon it. We share the sun's light. But we experience the sun in different ways, at different times, depending on where we are. Just like people on the other side of the earth are in nighttime. It's dark where they are on the other side of the earth, but we're experiencing light. And tomorrow, depending on where we are, we will see the eclipse in different ways. Some people won't see it at all. Some of us will be in 93.9% of the path of totality, and others will be in the total path of totality. We each experience the world from our own perspectives, and what we experience is what is true. To understand our world and our place in it, we need to consider everyone's wisdom, experiences, and insights to fill in the whole picture of what is true. By learning and experiencing the world together in community, we bridge the gaps in our understanding of the universe. It makes me think of our hymn called Building Bridges. So if you know it, sing with me. Building bridges between our divisions, I reach out to you, will you reach out to me? With all of our voices and all of our visions, friends, we can make such sweet harmony. Thank you. To settle in now for a time of sharing the joys and sorrows of this community. If you have a joy or a sorrow you would like spoken aloud, you can write it in the book that's found at the table at the back just as you enter the sanctuary. You can send me or Reverend Susan an email, depending on which one of us is leading service, or you can fill out the Google form found on the homepage of our website. We listen to these offerings with tenderness and with respect, so let's quiet our bodies and our minds and our voices as best we are able by taking in together a deep breath and letting it out. These are the joys and sorrows that have been shared before the service today. Andy Fisher writes, I'm sure I share the concern with many others about the terrible bombing by an Israeli rocket of the World Kitchen. Central World Kitchen food bus in Gaza. Rachel Heiss writes, to remember Craig Foster, we miss you and hope you found the peace you could not receive in your earthly body. Kristen Lems writes, holding in the light my cousin Greg Lems, whose beautiful and generous spouse Sarah Bunkenberg Lems, I hope I said that right, died this week, 8 months after a surprise diagnosis of butterfly glioma. She raised hundreds of thousands of dollars for juvenile diabetes research in an annual 100-mile ride she made for more than 20 years. Love and care to Greg and their two daughters, Katrina and Megan. A joy from our affiliated community minister, Reverend Elizabeth Harding. She has accepted a part-time position as staff chaplain for palliative care at UIC. She starts her new job in a few weeks and is very happy for this new opportunity. Yes, we're very happy for you, Elizabeth. A joy and a sorrow from Les Butler and Laura Loschutz. A joy that Les has healed from her knee replacement surgery and is quite mobile. A sorrow that Laura has fractured her knee and is on crutches for at least the next 4 weeks. All wrapped in a joy that we are able to take turns caring for one another. Glad you're here. A sorrow that we share with Stephen Eason and Liz Kennedy. Stephen's mom died this week after a difficult time of illness. We are holding Stephen and Liz in our hearts and prayers. For those of you who haven't met Stephen, he is our custodian who, along with Liz, makes our building and our sanctuary sparkle and shine each week. We are so grateful to both of them, and we're so sorry for this loss. From Carol Mergel, my friend Gail passed away in the early hours Saturday morning. We've known each other since kindergarten. She had been battling Addison's disease for over 30 years. I'll be going to my hometown in Indiana at some point this week for the funeral. Sean Talmadge shares this sorrow. My good friend Brooke Heimbaugh died on Monday. He had a stroke last Friday and had been fighting late-stage esophageal cancer in Austin, Texas for more than a year. He was a groomsman at my and Susan's wedding 26 years ago. I talked with him over the years, and this is a hard reminder of how precious each day is and that we never know when we will have our last conversation. And finally, we acknowledge Eid al-Fitr this week, the end of the holy month of Ramadan, the time when Muslims believe the Quran was first revealed to Muhammad. We pray for unity, for understanding and respect as this holy time concludes for our Muslim neighbors and friends. May we learn from one another and build bridges of compassion. We pray for peace and harmony and reconciliation between people of all faiths. Sharing these concerns of the heart is part of the practice of beloved community. We know that though we read many sorrows and some joys this morning, there are so many more out in the world and in this room. So we lift up those sorrows and joys by lighting a candle together. So you're invited to come forward now to light a candle at one of the three stations at the front. And if you would need a candle brought to you, please raise your hand and we'll bring one to you. for these joys, we give our thanks. For these sorrows, we give our love. Please join me in the spirit of prayer and meditation. Spirit of life, source of love and creative power, give us strength and wisdom as we hold the collective fears and sorrows and celebrations of this community and the wider world. As we bear witness to and experience in different ways the devastation of war, violence, and injustice, help us to resist numbness or hardening of our hearts. As we experience illness and loss, help us to stay present to each other and to be gentle with ourselves. Help us to tend the fragile flame of hope born in the possibility of community. We join our prayers for peace and liberation for everyone everywhere, for the ability to withstand the inevitable suffering of living and to discover the joy and beauty, the rays of sunshine that break through the clouds of weariness and despair. Help us draw from the divine source of love so that we might be that light and that energy to one another. Amen and blessed be. As we sing our song response number 1002, Comfort Me, our young people preschool through 12th grade are invited to head to their faith formation time with their adult leaders.
As we say in our covenant each Sunday, service is our law. UCE is called by our mission, values, and principles to contribute to our community, to form accountable partnerships, and to express gratitude through giving. Today's offering will be shared with Interfaith Action of Evanston, whose mission is to bring people together, to serve hungry and homeless people, to pursue interfaith dialogue, and to engage in advocacy that promotes social justice.
I know you're hearing a lot from me today, more than you usually would. And normally we'd have somebody make this pitch, but I'm speaking to you not as your minister in this moment, but as a board member of Interfaith Action and this longstanding community partner. Interfaith Action has been a force for good in our community for more than 50 years. It's a coalition of faith communities working together to address hunger and homelessness in Evanston and the surrounding areas in a number of ways. It hosts the Hospitality Center down the street at St. Mark's Church, which is open every Monday through Friday from 7 to 11 a.m. And the Hospitality Center guests have a warm place, a dry place to rest, to eat breakfast, to use computers, and get job counseling. Interfaith Action also has a number of afternoon warming centers and a weekend warming center during the cold season, housed at different faith communities. They sponsor several of the free evening meals that take place in Evanston every night of the week throughout the year. Beth Emmett is the host of the meal every Wednesday, except during their high holidays, and our congregation takes those Wednesday meals for them, which is coming up next on April 24th. Interfaith Action volunteers distribute 11,000 pounds of fresh produce through the Produce Mobile monthly on the second Tuesdays, and congregations, including ours, host the Interfaith Action overnight shelter 30 weeks of the year. So here at UCE, for 3 weeks, we house about 30 people overnight so they don't have to sleep outside in the cold. We're only able to do that through our partnership with Interfaith Action. It helps us to live our values of justice, equity, and compassion, and interdependence in concrete ways. I could go on and on about the good work that this organization does, but I know that many of you already know because you have volunteered with and through Interfaith Action for many years. I hope that as we as a congregation can keep our support for this vital organization and their efforts growing strong. You may text to give, you may mail in a check, put cash in the collection bowls, or give from our website. If you write a check, please indicate in the memo line if your check is for the shared offering or some other giving. The ushers will now come forward to pass the collection bowls down the rows. Please give as generously as you are able, and may what you give bring you joy. Thank you, Gregory. And thank you for your generosity. Our reading is The Butterfly Effect by Reverend Julian Jamaica Soto in the book Spilling the Light. I wish the knowledge were easier to come by that individualism is just a scam, that you are always the butterfly wings, you are always the storm. Edward Lorenz, a weather scientist from MIT, is sometimes misquoted on this, as the premise that the flap of a butterfly wing can cause a hurricane in a different part of the world. Shorthand that isn't all that close to a representation of the math-turned-weather scientist's work. He proposed that, should we make even a tiny alteration to nature, We will never know what would have happened if we had not disturbed it, since subsequent changes are too complex and entangled to restore a previous state, which is to say that you have an immeasurable effect on the system. It will change and you will shape the DNA. You must not believe the lying lie that you do not matter, that whatever change you can organize is so insufficient as to not be worth your time, your energy, your life force. You must be willing to dream a dream that carries forward your community. This is how we rise. This day is polluted with a mistrust of truth, fertile and warm medium for unchecked cruelty and power. You must choose to scream the truth until every leaf and stone bears unrepentant witness to what happens when you try to cage and smash, to pin and frame a butterfly and their thousands and thousands of fabulous flamboyant friends.
Thank you. all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
I think nature's imagination is so much greater than man's. He's never gonna let us relax, relax, relax.
Where things change, all right, but according to patterns, rules, or as we call them, laws of nature.
I'm this guy standing on a planet. Really, I'm just a speck. I'm just a speck compared with a star. The planet is just another speck. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space. There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks. The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of smart stuff. We are away from the cosmos to know itself.
Across the sea of space, the stars are other suns. We've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
We're all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm sorry that the subtitles don't translate when you download it, and I added that to Adam's job yesterday, a little last minute, so apologize. But I love that video, and one of you beloveds sent it to me recently, and I just thought it fit really well. Neil deGrasse Tyson, it's called Symphony of Science. There's all these videos like this where they use these great scientists' quotes and meld them into music. And Neil deGrasse Tyson says, we are all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically. This essential truth is evident all around us, from the air we breathe to the water we drink and the ground we reside on. We are an inseparable part of the natural world, and the natural world moves in, around, and through all of us all the time. And yet the busyness and the struggles of our daily lives make it easy for us to forget or to take for granted our interdependence, how much we need one another, and how much we are needed. Our current principles list the seventh as our covenant to affirm and promote the respect for the interdependent web of existence of which we are a part. It is a reminder that we are a small but significant part of all that is. The focus of Earth Month is rightly on our responsibility to care for the planet, and doing so means being in relationship with one another, each individual bringing their unique gifts to the process. In an essay about the seventh principle, UU Minister Reverend Forrest Gilmore wrote, quote, our seventh principle is a glorious statement, yet we make a profound mistake when we limit it to merely an environmental idea. It is so much more. It is our response to the great dangers of both individualism and oppression. It is our solution to the seeming conflict between the individual and the group. Individualism can be understood as the enemy of interdependence, or it can be understood as a necessary companion. This month's Soul Matters theme is interdependence, and I know I'm repeating myself here, but it's important for us to remember that the Unitarian Universalist Association's guiding documents, the seven principles, which were adopted in 1985, along with the eighth principle, which has been adopted in recent years by many congregations, including this one, are currently under review, as is required by our bylaws every 15 years. A proposal for a new articulation of our principles into six value statements emanating out of the core value of love will be voted on in our June General Assembly, which will be all virtual, so hopefully more accessible to most of you. And one of the six values around that core of love is interdependence, and it reads, we honor the interdependent web of all existence. Sounds familiar, right? With reverence for the great web of life, and with humility, we acknowledge our place in it. And then, with a call to living this value, we covenant to protect Earth and all beings from exploitation. We will create and nurture sustainable relationships of care and respect, mutuality, and justice. We will work to repair harm and damaged relationships. I appreciate this language of interdependence, that it isn't just about our responsibility to the planet and includes our responsibility to each other and to all of life. I love that it includes the language of mutuality and relationship. This proposed value of our wider faith movement is in harmony with our stated values as a congregation. A few years ago, UCE adopted and created and adopted four value statements that guide our purpose and our work together. Our fourth value as a congregation reads, we engage in our interconnected world. Again, we're hearing common themes here, by forming diverse and lasting connections in the community and acting for peace, social and environmental and economic justice. A lot of big lofty words I just threw at you, right? And they are hard to realize. In theory, it's easy to acknowledge our interdependence, but in practicality, it's hard to be dependent on each other and on systems that don't always protect those who are most vulnerable or ensure that the well-being of each isn't swallowed or flattened by the normative or dominant whole. An important counterbalance to our understanding that all life is connected is that we are all only a part of the infinite web of existence, and that we recognize life's diversity and celebration of the uniqueness of each individual being. Unitarian Universalism has historically been a heretical faith movement in which individualism has been championed. Our forebears have often pushed against the dangers of groupthink and resisted a cultish following of overly simplistic dogma. It's sort of what we're known for. But too great an emphasis on the needs of the individual can quite obviously be problematic. When an individual's needs or desires takes precedence over the well-being of the whole, we call that tyranny. But the other extreme is a form of collectivism that can erase individual rights and freedoms. Privileging the dominant and marginalizing diversity is how racism, transphobia, and ableism work. We must resist the mental shortcut of thinking that we are all one, so each one doesn't matter. Faith communities like ours can help foster a balance of individualism and interdependence. In an opinion piece by in The Atlantic this week, agnostic Derek Thompson, who previously did not view the decline in religion in America as any great loss, wrote, quote, only in the past few years have I come around to a different view. Maybe religion, for all its faults, works a bit like a retaining wall to hold back the destabilizing pressure of American hyper-individualism, which threatens to swell and spill over in its absence. One of the defining paradoxes central to a UU theology, and one of the things that we get right if we work at it, is the necessary balance between interdependence and individual freedom. When we live our principles and values as a whole, we can make real the truth that we are all part of the vast and infinite web of life, and as individuals, we are inherently worthy of love and dignity. There is a necessary tension between individualism and interdependence, a dance that requires mindfulness. It's not that we should silence or erase our individuality, that our individual selves don't matter. It's that we need to be individuals, complex and beautiful in our diversity within the complex and beautiful interdependent web. We need not flatten the inherent value of the individual to rejoice in the oneness of the whole. Again, a nice idea in theory and quite another in practice. Building something together, be it a model airplane or a coalition for peace, is always more complicated when people are involved. Life would be so much simpler if it weren't for all the people. And of course, as Jewish theologian and philosopher Martin Buber taught, we are only fully human in and through relationship. We need one another to survive, as the great song by Hezekiah Walker says, I need you, you need me, you are important to me, I need you to survive. We are only able to be fully human, accomplishing all that we are able to co-create in this world through our interdependence with each other. And yet working together is so complicated and messy. Just holding a conversation is rarely simple. We often think one thing and say something else, or we say something and it's heard completely differently than what we mean. Just as we talked about in our Time for All Ages, we each see the world through a slightly different perspective, our own. It's the only one we can see the world through. And becoming entrenched in our own perspectives is a real danger that we are all living in and bearing witness to every day. In order to transform the world into one more loving, just, and whole, we have to navigate each other, rely on each other, and pay attention to each other, aware of how our actions and inactions and words impact all others. This past Wednesday, the Evanston Roundtable published a statement that the interfaith clergy have been working on for over a month. We've written many statements and taken many actions together over the years, but this was different. The crisis in Israel and Gaza has required more nuance, sensitivity, listening, and attuned relationship building than anything we've ever responded to. It's not a perfect statement, and I don't know what its impact will be, but the way we stayed in conversation throughout the process, through disagreements on language and position, has been transformative. And I think we came up with something meaningful. Part of staying in the process has included coordinating several opportunities to learn together and to help our congregations and community learn together. This past Tuesday was the latest event that furthered my conviction that building solidarity is a critical component in all our endeavors to make the world more whole. Solidarity is about individuals coming together across lines of difference to create a shared society, mutual empowerment, and collective liberation. It is about individuality and interdependence moving together to create greater possibility. On Tuesday, two representatives of the organization Standing Together, Rula Daoud and Itamar Avneri, spoke to a large crowd at Lake Street Church about solidarity in the context of the crisis they've been living amidst for all their lives. Standing Together is a grassroots movement mobilizing Jewish and Palestinian citizens of Israel in pursuit of peace, equality, and social and climate justice. Rula and Itamar spoke powerfully of the false narrative that those in power, in their case, the Israeli government and Hamas, want to perpetuate. When asked about Zionism and anti-Zionism, about the polarity of positions they find most prevalent in the United States, they considered it unhelpful. Israel exists. Israelis exist, as do Palestinians. 14 million people, 7 million each, on a tiny piece of land. When asked about how it was possible to come together across such intractably opposing sides, they suggested taking the side of the people, all the people, not the government or those in power who stand against the well-being of everyone. This is what solidarity means to them, working together for the liberation and equality of all people. It made me think of the Unitarian Universalist Side with Love Social Justice Project. Our values call us to side with love. Like anything worth the struggle, taking the side of love is not simple or easy. It's much easier to take opposing sides and contribute to false dichotomies. When our perspectives become entrenched, collective liberation suffers. When interdependence allows dominant culture to wash out the needs and rights of minority perspectives, people suffer. We need interdependence and individualism to be in relationship. We are in a moment of needing to come together to hear different perspectives, to be open to a variety of viewpoints. We are in a moment when we need to prioritize how we are in conversation and relationship as individuals interdependently working toward peace and liberation. As our conversations around a proposed ceasefire resolution begin today, I want to call us all to hold at the center how we are together above whatever words are chosen and voted on. I want us to acknowledge that no one of us has all the answers, all the wisdom, or the right path to peace. Whatever statement is finalized to be voted on as a congregation in May will have little positive impact on the crisis in Gaza if its larger impact here causes us to be further entrenched or polarized if we can't hold sacred the individual humanity of each of us. Being in covenantal community makes the difficult conversations that we need to have possible. Let us hold each other in love and accountability above all else as we have them, as we practice being individuals in interdependent solidarity. May what we learn here enable us to promote these values beyond our congregation. So much in our lives creates a sense of isolation, separation, and distrust that counters the interdependence we know is the truth. We are led to believe the lying lie that we are not all connected. We are pulled apart by ideological bubbles that further entrench our positions and pushed apart by capitalism and the tragedies of injustice and abusive power that consume our lives. Let us commit ourselves anew through the practice of building beloved community, co-creating a state of solidarity where each unique and individual life is honored and celebrated as we join together to struggle interdependently toward wholeness. May we work ever to make it so.
As we extinguish the chalice, please join in saying the words on the screen by the Reverend Elizabeth Sell Jodith. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Please rise in body or spirit and join in singing our closing hymn.
Oh,
honor our profound interdependence with the earth, with each other, and with all life, even as we rejoice in our individuality and work to create a beloved community for all. Let us go making peace, beloveds.